Gospel according to St. John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their table. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and will you raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this. And they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. I found this little gem online, and it reminds me of today's gospel lesson. A South Carolina woman returned home from vacation to find another family had moved into her recently purchased home. Upon arriving to the home, Catherine Lane noticed a dog and a cat wandering the property, as well as a pair of women talking inside, the Beaufort, South Carolina Gazette reported. Hopefully we don't have this problem on Friday. "I said, 'What are you doing in my house?'" Lane told the paper. It became clear to me what had happened. It turns out that Tigra Shepherd, age 22, who thought she had found the perfect place to settle in her family as they relocated from Kentucky, was a victim of an online scam, the paper reported. Shepherd told the paper she found this three-bedroom furnished home advertised in a Facebook group for $8.50 a month, posted by a woman named Rosie Ruggles. She wired $1,150 for the fake lease and was told to use the unlocked back door to start moving her belongings into the house because the person delivering the keys had been arrested. Lane bought the house in October, but was still living at her previous home, waiting for it to sell. After returning from a brief vacation, she decided to check on the pipes due to the recent cold weather, and that's when she noticed the unwelcomed guests. The schedule has been set for Shepherd to move out, and Lane has decided to soon move into her new home, finally. I wonder if this is how Jesus felt as he entered the temple complex at Passover, turning the tables and scattering the money changers and the animals every which way with this whip in his hand. "Take these things out of here. Stop making my father's house a marketplace." Now, to be fair, the merchants who were gathered outside the enormous temple structure in Jerusalem were offering a necessary service to those who had traveled from afar to celebrate Passover. Of course, there's always room for fraud in any good doing, especially considering our sinful natures. But for the most part, these merchants at the temple were performing a service that had a long history in Jerusalem. Families were required to offer certain animals for their yearly sacrifice, and it was impossible for those who were coming to Jerusalem to drag the particular animal all the way to the temple from their distant homes. The animals wouldn't survive the trip. So there were merchants available to sell proper to be sacrificed animals. And also the money used at the temple needed to be changed from Roman coins to Herod's temple currency. This cleansing of the temple by Jesus had less to do with the cottage industry that had developed over time, taking place in proximity to the temple, and more to do with Jesus proclaiming that he was the Son of God. You know, Passover was designed by God. Get this. Passover was designed by God to remember God. Remember, I am the Lord your God who brought you up out of Egypt. Remember. And God reminded the children of Israel of this quite often in the desert. God had to remind Israel this very fact because, well, often they forgot. So Passover was a day to remember. And over time, the people of Israel, had forgotten what it was that they were to remember. And instead of God being central, humankind wanted to become central. And when that happens, it's called sin, by the way. Not a new concept, just a reality that is forgotten. When that happens, the first remain first and the last remain last. Jesus came to bring the good news of the God to this world, that the first will be last and the last will be first. He turned the tables, that those who are in bondage will be set free, and that we are to seek first the kingdom of God. That's what Jesus got in trouble with the current religious and economic establishment. In re-establishing his deity, the tables were turned. The cleansing of the temple is found in all four Gospels. There's one minor difference. The whip is only used in John. But the major difference is where the story is placed. Matthew, Mark, and Luke place Jesus' turning of the tables after Jesus enters Jerusalem, after Palm Sunday as we know it, during Holy Week. In John's Gospel, Jesus is establishing his authority in the beginning of his ministry, right after he turns water into wine at Cana of Galilee. Whether this plays out at the beginning of Jesus' ministry or at the end of Jesus' ministry, Jesus makes his point, and it is the whip cracking that is heard around the world. I appreciate that the lectionary has moved us back to the Gospel of John as it did in the season of Epiphany, because just prior to this chapter 2 account, John tells Jesus' story in words that are very familiar to us. Jesus was the Word that was in the beginning with God. All things came into being because of him. In him was life, and the life was the light of all people. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own received him not. Give us a sign why you do this, the people wanted to know. What right do you have to disrupt our worship of God? John bears witness that Jesus was full of grace and truth. And from the fullness we have received grace upon grace. Jesus held the entire world in his hand. Yet he gave his life for that world. That is Jesus' story. What is our Lenten story in the midst of God's story? we are exhorted to return to God with all our hearts. It's about remembering who God is and whose we are. It's about remembering who it is we worship and not what it is we worship. How it is that all the ways in which we worship that you have participated in so far in the service today, all of those ways are to bring us to God. Each and every time we are washed in the baptismal waters, God is reestablished in our lives. Today, at the table will be turned. We remember Christ's love for us. We remember his death. We remember his burial. We remember his resurrection. We remember that he will come again. Just as the disciples remembered, we remember God today. That, my friends, is our Lenten story.